As you're seated in the presence of God, you know, this morning I want to talk about the place of significance. But you know, the place of significance that God has for each and every one of us comes first from the understanding of the destiny that God has put, God has placed, God has prepared for each and every one of us. First, there is a destiny for all of mankind. In Genesis chapter 1, verse 26, the Word of God says, "And God showed His intent and His destiny has for you and I, for all of humanity, when He said, 'Let us make man.'" Now, man there does not just refer to Adam. We are, and God sees that, we are in Adam, even as Adam was first created. That's why in theological sense, we call it the seminal head. He is the federal head. And even though we were not there when God created the first man, He saw us in that first man itself. That's why the Bible says He knew us from the very foundations of the earth, because that plan was already conceived. And He said, "Let us make man in our image and after our likeness." And there was a purpose. He said, "Let them then have dominion." You know, sometimes we may not understand the word dominion. We think of dominion as just be able to take and have what we want, to be able to rule and even to abuse if we want to. But the word dominion doesn't mean just to have things your way. How many know there's a responsibility even in dominion? A government is not elected that they can govern the way they want to do it. But in dominion, there is responsibility and there's also an accountability. And I want you to hear this. God made us so awesomely, so fearsomely, so precious. In all of creation, the Bible just records for us, all that God did was He said, and He called the things which be not as though they were. But in Genesis 2:7, when He came to man, the Bible says He lovingly took the dust of the earth. He fashioned. And not only did He fashion, He then breathed. He breathed His very life. What is that life of God? Sometimes we don't understand. That life of God, yes, God created man, that man can have dominion. I want you to hear this. Not just on earthly dimensions. We are created to have dominion also in heavenly dimensions. As God created the heavens and the earth, He created man to be a spirit and a body. Amen. And when He breathed His life in, the Bible says man became a living soul. I want you to hear this today. You were fearfully, you were awesomely made to be a God. I'm not speaking heresy here. Amen. I just want you to see this, how God views us. When He breathed His life, that God life is the very dimension of what God is. What is God? Well, He pre-existed before even the heavens and the earth were created. How does God describe Himself? We see glimpses as God calls Himself a glory. There was that realm of the glory of God. And that glory of God manifested. Manifested what? God Himself. His love. His glory. And I've said before that we may not fully understand. But I want to tell you this. That glory was intended that man can not only live in the spiritual, in the natural, but also have dominion. And dominion the way God has put His life in us. And there is a time to come when you and I will be in the eternity with God as one. But now, there is a role of dominion. In that dominion, we need to understand that God not only has a plan for mankind, He's got a plan individually. You know, as I was preparing for this, God led me to meditate on Jeremiah chapter 1, verse 5. Very interesting verse. In Jeremiah chapter 1, verse 5, God was actually talking to Jeremiah. And he begins to tell Jeremiah something which sets a pattern for us to understand God's plan for us individually. In Jeremiah chapter 1, he says, "Before I formed thee in the belly." King James Version. You know what I'm saying? Before you were conceived even. Before all this, he said this word, "I knew you." Wow. I just want that word to sink in first. Before you were even conceived in your mother's womb. This word of God tells us, as he spoke to the prophet Jeremiah, he said, "I already knew you." And the word "knew" is so unique. The Bible reminds us that God knows every part of us, every physical part, right down to every hair that is on your body. He knows how your minds work. He knows how your heart works. He knows because he breathed his very persona. He breathed his very self and nature and character into us. You know what the Quran says? "And before you came out of the womb." Wow. Before you were conceived, he knew you. Before you were birthed out, he said, "I sanctified you." Some versions use the word, "I consecrated you." And in a consecration, there's always a plan and a purpose. And I, what the Bible says, ordained. That's what the King James Version says. Other versions say, "I appointed you." I appointed you what? To be a prophet to nations. You see, that was for Jeremiah. But I want you to understand that this same equation applies. And God is saying, listen to this formula. Before you were even conceived in mother's womb, I already know you. I already have a plan for your life. I really, really, before you were born, I already consecrated you. I already prepared you for a purpose. Jeremiah was to be a prophet. What has God appointed you to be? Yes, there is to be a God in this world. To be able to rule and to reign. To be able to be responsible for and be accountable for even what God has entrusted to us. But even more, God says you have a special, specific purpose. Amen. Look at somebody and say, he's talking about you. Do you know there's about 7 billion people in the world today? And I would just want to see the magnitude of this. And there's 7 different people with specific DNAs, different fingerprints, different uniquely, individually. And you know, God has a plan for mankind, but he's got a plan for your life individually. And I always love to look at Jeremiah 29 because Jeremiah 29 gives us a very, very important understanding. And God says in this in verse 11, "For I know the thoughts I think towards you." Some version says, "For I know the plans I have for you, saith the Lord of hosts. And they are thoughts of peace." Some versions will say, "Plans that are good." And you read on, it says, "And not of evil." Now, I want to tell you this. Sometimes we don't understand things of God. And sometimes when we are facing situations, we cannot see goodness, we can only see evil. Even like recently, there was a lot of talk about cults and all the different other religions around. And some people actually said, you know, these are evil people. I want to tell you something. Something rankled in me. How many know that? Everyone, whether we believe in Jesus Christ or not, all made in the image and after likeness of God. Whether we accept Him as Lord and Savior or not, I want to tell you this. We may be doing evil things. We may be influenced and under domain of the evil one. But I want you to hear this, each and every one of you. No one is evil. We are created all in the image and likeness of God. That's why I don't believe in judging anyone. It's not for us to judge anybody. Yes, we do see people doing wrong things. We need to evaluate sometimes. But how many know that as we evaluate, as a people of God, and I will expand a bit on this, and that's our place of significance, influence, is not to condemn. Amen? We have a role. We have a destiny. As we bring the influence, the love, the glory of God into a dimension, what happens? We are always to restore people. Amen? We are always to be praying for them. We are always and must have the heart to love them. Even though in our eyes, in our natural, they may be totally unlovable. Have you met people like that? Yes. I always joke about it. I say some people, only mother can love. But I want to tell you something. Yet, none of them are evil in the eyes of God. Because they were made in the very image and after the likeness of God. Amen? And this is important. Understand this. And Jeremiah 29:12 says this. When we understand this, that God has a good plan and not evil, God wants to give you, some versions say expected end, some version will tell you a hope and a future. He says when you understand this dimension, and that's important, do you understand that ultimately He has the plan? Ultimately, He's still in control. Although He gave us freedom of choice today, ultimately, God still has a hope and a future for you. And if you understand that, he says in the next verse, then you understand that indeed, He's the source of all goodness. That He's the centrality of everything. He's the giver of life. And only in Him alone can we live, can we move, and have our whole being. It says, then, what is then? Then shall you call upon me. Amen. Unless we get this perspective right, unless we understand the destiny that God has for all of humanity, unless you understand the destiny that God has for you individually, he says, then you will begin to call upon me. And you shall go and pray unto me. Very interesting. He didn't say, I will answer you. He said, I will hear you. And you shall seek me. And find me when you search for me with all your heart. I want you to see this word, with all your heart. You see, the biggest problem today is this. We can know intellectually, notionally, that God is good. We can intellectually know that Him, all things come. But it's one thing to intellectually know, but another to have the conviction in your heart that your intensity, your whole focus becomes trying to align yourself. You begin to align yourself to the very plan and the purpose of God rather than our own individual agendas, our own plans, our own hopes, our own desires. And he says, when you find me, when you shall search with all your heart. Many people say to me, but pastor, I've been trying to look for God. But I want to tell you something. Maybe you have not come to a point of desperation. First, to understand that he's the source of everything. Second, is to search for him with all your heart. I can only tell you something. If you do that, you always find God. Amen? It's true. God, sometimes that's why he allows things to happen. That we come to a point of abject desperation. Not just desperation. I call it abject desperation. When you reach a stage the Bible in Psalm 107 say, when you reach wit's end. Wit's end is that you know nothing can do anything anymore. Nothing you can trust in anymore. Cantonese say, chow tang mulo. When you reach a point when you hit the wall. Some people don't know when they hit the wall. And they start running into the wall again and again. Yeah, I'm serious. You see, what constrains us? You know, I was just thinking about this, and God reminded me of my pets. One of them is a dog that he always wants to come to the room to follow us. So sometimes we close the door, but it's not clicked on. But other times we close hard, it's clicked on. And he will come and he use his head, bang. But he doesn't stop, he go bang. Because experience tell him, he push, he can go through. So he can't accept the fact that the door is bolted. And he'll keep banging until we open the door. Oh. You know what God said? Sometimes we need to understand that it's not about what experience taught us, but who God is. And if you persistently, consistently search for him, he always opens the door. Amen. I hear one amen there. He says, and I will be found of you, saith the Lord. And when you find the Lord, what happens? Here comes these words. And I will turn away your captivity. I will gather you from all the nations and from all the places whither I have driven you. Interesting thing. It is God that actually is a God of situations. How many know that nothing ever happens if God did not first permit it? And though we may not understand, God says, your ways are not my ways. Your thoughts are not my thoughts. Amen. His is higher. Many times I don't understand too. But he says here, where I've driven you, said the Lord, and I will bring you again into a place whence I caused you to be carried away captive. Listen to these words in verse 15. Because you have said, the Lord hath raised up prophets in Babylon. You see, wherever you think the voice of God is speaking, that's where you will go to. Have you not realized that God is everywhere? God speaks to his prophets even in this generation. But we need to understand this. That for God to be present everywhere, but yet we need to be in the presence of God. Amen. It's in the presence of God that we can hear him. It's the presence of God, the word of God says, there's a fullness of joy. Amen. And when the joy of the Lord is with you, you can have strength. Amen. You can only draw strength. You'll find that you draw peace to overcome. And as you draw peace to overcome, you are raised from faith to faith. And you begin to manifest that which has God put in you from glory to glory. Amen. That he be glorified. Amen. We don't stop at to glory, that we be glorified. Amen. And by the works, Jesus said, the Father in heaven will be glorified. And so we need to understand this. We need to understand that God has set this as a formula for us. 2 Chronicles 20:20. I love this. It's your whole belief system. It says, believe in the Lord your God, so shall you be established. But believe in the prophets, so shall you prosper. You see, God not only wants you to be established, God wants to be the continued guidance for you. He wants to be leading. He doesn't take away your will. He doesn't take away your intellect. He doesn't take away your choice. He doesn't take away the decisions you have to make. He doesn't take away your processing, even circumstance, situation, to make a right decision. God is there to want to put and speak into an input in your life to only lead and guide you. Amen. Amen. Okay? So don't let God say, God will be the only one that make decisions. God has put choice and decision in our hands. And this is important. So as we understand our destiny, we need to enter into our destiny. As I was preparing for today, the Lord led me to Revelation chapter 17, verse 14. And here I came across a very interesting verse here. And these words came out in verse 17, chapter 17, verse 14. And he talks about a time when there shall be war. Who makes war with God? The devil himself. Okay? And the Lamb overcome them. For he is, verse 14 say, the Lord of lords and the King of kings. But he is not just the Lord of lords and kings of kings, but there are some with him. And the Bible says, and they that are with him are called, I saw three words, called, chosen, and faithful. You know, I wrestled with this for a long time. I said, God, I thought we all had a destiny. I thought all of us had a call. And then Jesus reminded me of the words he said. Many are called, but few are chosen. And I began to ask God, why are many called, but few are chosen? And I'm actually quoting from Matthew 24, verse 14 also. In there, Jesus talks about wedding feasts, a parable wedding feast. Many people were invited. Were they chosen? Yes, otherwise they wouldn't be invited. But yet, many chose not to come. You know what Lord spoke to me? I've called. I've chosen. And he said this to me, my choice is that I'll not want to judge anybody. I'll rather all will come to saving knowledge. I'll rather that none should perish. But yet, how we respond will determine whether we are not only called, but we are among those chosen. And this is very important. Called and chosen, two words, two C's. But yet, it depends on our response. And this is very important. And the Lord spoke this word, these three words, chosen, called, chosen, and faithful, are actually very three fundamental important things out of which authentic disciples. I want to hear this. Authentic disciples. It means if they're authentic disciples, there are some unauthentic disciples. Right, conclusion? That many think they are disciples of Jesus Christ and yet may not be disciples as the Lord sees them. The Bible shows us a time in the life of Jesus when Jesus saw the multitudes. He looked at the multitudes. Who are multitudes? They are people that are following Jesus. Everywhere he went, there were all these multitudes. There are people who must believe in something. I want to tell you this, just believing and just following yourself does not make one a disciple. Because here comes a multitude following the good shepherd, and the good shepherd looks at them, and he saw them as what? Sheep without a shepherd. You see, authentic discipleship is not just about wanting to follow Jesus. Authentic discipleship, I want you to hear this, it's not just about attending church on Sundays. Authentic discipleship is about a transition. Yes, that's a time of preparation. In a time of preparation, 2 P, that you learn to position yourself. In the time of positioning, what are you positioning for? Are you positioning for the plan and purposes of God? Or are you positioning for the plan and purposes of your own desires of your heart? And that's very important. And this is important because many of us, just because we attend the church, we think we're disciples. This is something that we tried to explain when I preach about this discipleship. And I've shared with you all how God revealed authentic discipleship between the verses of, speak to me, Matthew chapter 4. Oh, I forgot already. Verse 23, Matthew chapter 9, verse 35, you see two identical verses. It what? Brackets. And there you see this. And the Lord spoke this to me. You know what's the problem? You know why a lot of people are going to church and they are not authentic? Because look at the very word church. What does church mean? What does church mean? Remember, it's upon these things that Jesus said, I will build my church. And the word church is very interesting. If you look at the Greek word, it's the word ecclesia. And ecclesia really talks about a calling out. Means the church is about people who are called out ones. What are they called out from? Not just called out of a congregation, no. It's called out of darkness into His marvelous light. It's not just coming and attending church. It's about living and to be the man of a woman of destiny. And the authentic discipleship does not begin until there's a change of our attitudes. Remember all the Beatitudes talk about? And as we change in the attitudes, the heart will be changed. Then we're able to be the man and woman. You know what's the plan or purpose of God has for you? In a destiny for humanity to take dominion? He says two things. You are the light. I like that. He didn't say you may be the light, you can be the light, you will be the light. You are the light. If you believe in Jesus Christ, you are the light. Let's start with salt first. You know what salt is? And I've said this before, salt has two purposes. Salt is to preserve and salt is to enhance. I want you to tell you are called out for the purpose. To make a difference in the world. To be there to help preserve those who are lost, that you can bring them into salvation. You're here to the role, not only preserve, but to make it, enhance it, the flavor of those who are already believing in Jesus. Amen. Amen. And this is important. The salt never changes. But remember, a salt can be diluted, a salt can be adulterated. And in that, the salt loses its saltiness. Now we need to understand this. You see, if we don't understand the need for the right attitudes, a change of heart, we can't be the man or the woman of destiny that God wants us to be. When you believe in Jesus Christ, you're more than salt. You are to be the light. The light is like the city, he said, that's built on a hill. When a city is built on a hill, what happens? It cannot be hidden. Amen. When you see a city on a hill, it's on the hill. Unless you're blind, you'll still see the city. And he says, like the light. A light must shine. A light cannot be hidden. And how is a light shining? Jesus said in the same word, it's by the way we live our lives, that by your good works, people will glorify the Father. Because they cannot see God, but they can see how you live your life. Amen? So let your life light so shine. Make the difference wherever you go. Don't compromise. You know, I always joke about it. One other name to call Christians are secret agents. A lot of Christians are secret agents running around. You never know that they are Christians even. Not by the words they say, not by the way they live their lives. Amen. The secret agents. You only see them in church and, oh, Christian. But you see, Christianity is not just on Sunday. It's Monday to Saturday. It's Sunday after church. Amen. And this is important. How many know that your life cannot be hidden? It's like the city on the hill. And this is important. So when we understand that destiny, we must understand that we are called out. We are called out what? Now Matthew chapter 7 verse 14. I had this written down because the Lord spoke to me. You know, as we are called out. Turn with me to Matthew chapter 7 verse 14. and you see these words. Start with 13 first. Disciples are called by one thing. Enter in at the straight gate, for wide is the gate and broad is the way. I know when I say that, people thought of Broadway. Some of you think of Makanari after the service. Okay, but broad is the way that leads to destruction, and many there be which go in thereat. Verse 14. Because straight is a gate and narrow is a way which leadeth unto life. Now, this life is not about your breathing physical life. It's about the life of the glory of God that's already placed within you. And few there be that find it. Do you know why I read this? I said, God, how can it be? We are churches are growing. We have more mega church here, mega churches here in Singapore in that very small area. How many know that? But he says, here. What does he say here? But few there be that find it. Here comes the word. Why do few find it? Beware of false prophets which come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ravaging wolves. You shall know them by their fruits. Amen. What's the test of fruit? I've learned one thing. The real test of the fruit is when you start to eat them. It's true. Because sometimes I look at the orange, it looks very nice. But how many know that it's when you peel, it still looks like overripe, but by bite, already it's starting to rot. The test of it is by eating. You see, it's not just by listening, sitting, and just blindly following. It's partaking and living the life. And you will know. As you live the life, do you know why many people are getting deceived? Because there are too many ones who are being called out, are doing nothing but sitting in church, and sitting in church, and sitting in church. Amen. What are you called out? You're called out for a purpose. God didn't get you saved to sit in church. I know, Pastor, I get called out to serve in church. That's only a start. How many know the work of the church is outside the church? The word of the church is not here in the church. Don't get me wrong. Church is important. We need people to help with reception. We need to help people with as ushers. We need to help people with people to help with communion. With so many things that works on Sunday for a congregation to come together. But I want to tell you this. The real work of the church is God wants to call you out there. Amen. Amen. And this is important. How many of you are really serving God in some capacity outside the church itself? Okay, don't need answer. Don't put up your hands. Amen. And we need to understand this. And the key is this. The gate is narrow. Why? We all like to be in comfort zones. Amen. You know, it's one thing to be called out. But I want to say this. There's a danger we are swept back so easily. You see, there is also a need to persevere. Wow, people want to serve God. I remember the time God gave us a word to do Project Heartbeat. Oh, go down to the, up there. The one rumors give away food or thing. But you know that I couldn't get people to go beyond just that. Because it takes commitment. It takes sacrifice. It takes bringing you out of comfort zones. It makes you begin to realize that your righteousness is not just about sitting in church, but your righteousness be tested by people that become a pain in the neck. No, I'm serious. I had this problem too. We reach out. We try to help families out there. I remember there was one particular family, right? They had a problem. The father was not working. The mother was not working because she had problems. They had three young kids. So we tried to help. So we tried to help them pay off the electric bills that are not paid, the back rental that are not paid. And then we said, we got to do more than that. It's not just having a handout. So we tried to help the father get a job. Then I realized he had a problem. Why he couldn't get a job? Because he had a record. Okay? So even trying to get a job as a security officer cannot because of his record. So finally we got him a job. And this job was in a company just to be like directing traffic, you know. And second week, he come back again. Why? He quit the job. So I said, how can you quit the job? Why? He said that supervisor scolding me all the time. I cannot take it. No, he's not. Because maybe it's too late back. Maybe what? I don't know. But he got scolded. And you see, very thin skin, a bit for give up. Because some people like that, they have forgotten that they have a responsibility and accountability. Three children, a wife, but he's always looking for handouts. I mean, that job only gave him $1,200 a month. But that was better than nothing at all. But he couldn't take just a bit of scolding. Hello. How many know that everything out there in the world is still a fallen world? Nothing is just easy. God never said in this world you have no problems. He said in the world you're going to have tribulation. But it's only in Him that you have peace. Peace to what? To avoid problems? No. To overcome. Amen. And in life, there are things that we have to overcome. When we are called out, not always do you find things are comfortable. Not even talking about called out. Even right in church, you find that not everything's comfortable. Because there are people who upset you. There are people who irritate you. People that don't meet up to your right idea of a Christian. How many know that we got a lot of unexpressed expectations? And we get disappointed. We get offended. And what do? You see, God says, let us make man. This is a destiny. And let them. Let us make men, M-A-N, and let them. You see, the devil understands this. If the believers come together in a community, ready to be called out, working together, what happens? One of us put 1,000 to flight. Two of us put 10,000. And wherever three are gathered in His name, I want you to hear this. Christ is in the center of it all. If He be for us, the Word of God says what? Who can come against us? If God be with us, we will not only put 10,000 to flight. We're going to rout principality, powers, rulers, and spiritual wickedness in high places. Amen? And He understands, the devil understands, that destiny of man to take responsibility and dominion. Amen. And this is important for us to understand. You can never go up to a place of significance if you don't understand your destiny. Many are called, but few are chosen. Why? He says that, verse 7, verse 22, 23, and many will say to me in that day. When is that day? It's the day we stand before the Lord for judgment. How many know that? There is a time of judgment for believers as well as unbelievers. Who? I thought we are no more to be judged. Amen. There will be a time of judgment even for believers. And you notice something. The person said, did I not cast out demons in your name? Did I not do this? Did I not do that? What was the reply? Go back and read Matthew chapter 7, verse 22, 23. And this is important for us to understand. And a lot of times, we don't. I want to tell you, God expects fruitfulness. As we begin to position ourselves, prepare yourself, position yourself to align with what God wants you to do. God expects fruitfulness. Can I say amen? And this is important. Are you really wanting fruit in your life? Or are you going to be locked in? I don't want to cause problems. I don't want to cause offense. People, cannot take it. I want to tell you this. God wants to bring you into places that will not be comfortable. God wants to bring you into a dimension that you will find that there will be discomfort. Amen. Jesus never promised you comfort. And the big question I have to ask this to many people. Are you living your life for that day that is coming? Are you living your life? That's the only thing you have to answer. Or are you living just for today? Many people are living just for today. For here, for now. Because we are living for our needs. We are living for our busyness. We are living for our own agendas, our own ambitions. You know, I said this to somebody the other day. He said to me, Pastor, but you don't understand. I got so much needs and obligation. And as I talked further with him, I realized, you know why he got so much needs? He had 3 houses. He was up to his eyeball in debt. Why? So I said, why didn't you get this? But Pastor, you don't understand. One, I need to stay. 2 and 3 is my investment for the future. Hello? How many know that I've learned this? God is my future. Because I've learned this. I've learned that I became a rich man, had a lot of assets. But when things change, it all vaporized and disappeared. When I had nothing, I had everything. When I had nothing, then I could really trust God. And I learned something. If you align to do what God wants you to do, 2 words I said. I've learned one. God says a workman deserves his wages. Amen. Whatever company you work for, A, B, C, whatever, is not your employer. If you make God your employer to be able to do for him, God says that company is your paymaster that I used to pay you. Yeah. I think, and God said this. Workmen not only deserve wages, God is no man's debtor. It took me a long time to realize that I cannot be living for today, for today's needs. I need to be living for that day when I stand before God. And this is important for us to review, because even when we are ministering for God, sometimes we can forget. We are so caught up even with doing the things that God wants us to do that we lose the equation where God relationship is no more there. So this is important. Remember, it's not only important to be called, to be chosen, but to be found faithful. Amen? And this is so important. There's so much more I want to say. But I think I will close this time now with a story from the Bible. And as I was meditating on this, God led me to Genesis. And if you've got a Bible, you can turn with me down there. And Genesis, in the book of Genesis, okay? And I'm turning to a time in chapter 49. And Genesis chapter 49, you see a very important time, a very interesting time. And Jacob called unto his sons and said, gather yourselves together, that I may tell you that which shall befall you in the last days. You know, as I read this, I said, God, what's that got to do with destiny? God said, understand this. Jacob, the father in the natural, called his sons. Double, not only called, asked them to gather together. I'm looking at Genesis chapter 49, verse 1. And say, that I may tell you that which shall befall you in the last days. And the Lord spoke to you at once. He's not just telling, I'm going to tell you something about the future. But a prophetic word I feel here is that God says, that father was telling his son, I'm going to tell you something. There is that last days, that final day when you have to account before God, the time of the millennial. Do you know Jacob had that prophetic input? He was not calling his sons just to reprimand his sons. He was calling his sons, look, I need to tell you something. And then he's repeated this thing, gather yourselves together and hear, ye sons of Jacob, and hear unto Israel your father. You know how many times we refer to this? It means not only gather, listen to what I'm telling you, pay attention. And the Lord said there is a prophetic lesson to learn here. And Jacob began to speak a word over all his 12 children. But I just want to focus on three of them even right now. And the first was to his eldest son, Reuben. He said, Reuben, thou art my firstborn, my might and the beginning of my strength, the excellency of dignity and the excellency of power. You see, he began to speak about his firstborn. And he began to speak with such good hope. But then in the verse 2, he says, verse 4, he said, yet unstable as water. And then he said, thou shalt not excel. Because thou wentest up to thy father's bed, then defiled thou it. He went to my couch. So now, understand something. He was proud that Reuben was his firstborn. He was saying, in the firstborn, there's a lot of things. What's the firstborn's inheritance, so to speak? First, the firstborn always end up as the head of the family. Second, in terms of inheritance, the firstborn has a double portion. I will look at somebody right now. Turn to somebody, look at somebody. Amen. You are the firstborn. Amen. Each of us today are firstborn. Because the word of God tells us that Jesus came as a firstborn of God. Right? When he died, he became the firstborn of all creation. When he ascended, he birthed out the church of the firstborn. Every one of you have a good personal destiny. I'm not talking about the destiny, a destiny to manifest, to be like God, but I'm talking about a personal destiny. But what happened with Reuben? Well, very interesting. After his mother, Rachel, died, Reuben actually had an affair with Rachel's maid. But do you know who was Rachel's maid by that time? She had become his stepmother. And she already had given birth to two sons by Jacob. Who were the two sons? How do you remember? Okay, you're going to look at Genesis 35, you're going to see who the two sons are. But you see, what was Reuben's problem? You see, like the water in the river, sometimes what he's saying is uncontrollable. When floods come, you break its banks, it becomes destructive. In life, water is important for life. But yet waters, when it's not controlled, it becomes destructive. The word down here, very interesting. I studied the word, what they mean by this word, uncontrollable waters. And actually, the word in Hebrew has that meaning of being reckless and destructive. Wow, I couldn't understand that. I said, God, why reckless? You see, Reuben could not control himself. He was tempted by the lust of his flesh, the lust of his eyes. Perhaps he thought, I'm firstborn, I can do what I like. And this is the work of the devil. He always works for three things: the lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, and the pride of life. And all this often are manifested in three things. How many know that it exists even right now? When this lust comes in, when pride comes in, we think that we can do what we want to do. Three things that cause the fall of most leaders and men of God. You know what three things are? Money, sex, and power. I'll repeat it again. Money, sex, and power. And this is the problem of Reuben. He had a good destiny. He was a firstborn. He had such privilege. He was destined to be the head of the family after his father died. But let me tell you this, he lost his position. And it was recorded that Reuben never became of any leadership position, not in the family of Israel. Then the next thing that he began to address then, and I'll just talk about these three sons. And he talked about Simeon and Levi. And to them too, they are his sons. He had these words to start with. As he had for Reuben, he said, "You have instruments of cruelty." Wow. You see, Simeon and Levi became violent people of the sword. They became violent people of the sword because of good intention. Their own sister got raped. And so what did they do? They decided to take vengeance. Not only take vengeance. If you read the very interesting thing itself earlier, as they took vengeance, they also prided in themselves that they are children of the circumcision, that they are special, elect, and chosen of God. And in their revenge, it gave them the right not only against the person that raped, the ruler of that tribe that raped, but they wiped out the whole town. Do you know God spoke to me this? He said, "Do you know that today we are also children of a circumcision?" The circumcision as a mark was given that the people of the circumcision can be a blessing. The call of Israel, how many remember Isaiah said it? "Do you not know tribes of Israel? You are called with this high calling to be a light unto a Gentile, to be God's instrument for the salvation unto the ends of the earth." Do you know that we are today also called as children of circumcision? Amen. Praise God. As spiritual children of circumcision, you don't have to circumcise the flesh. But God is calling you to circumcise your heart. And in circumcising your heart is very important. It's how you respond. When there are people in our midst, for example, people make mistakes. How do you handle the situation? Do we go and condemn, judge, and begin to bring the hand of execution? Is this the love of God? I mean, I've been challenged with this. There are times that sometimes you feel that you have to put your foot down on certain things. But God said to me many times, "Remember, as a child of the circumcision, you got to learn to be a blessing. And the blessing is always about forgiveness, restoration." Amen. Hello. I'm not speaking to wrong people here. Amen. But it's important. And you see, Simeon and Levi also lost their inheritance. I don't want to teach about all the other children, but enough for us to remind us that we are in the days even right now. Okay? Jacob summoned his children to talk about the days to come. I ask you this question. Are you living a life for that day to come? That is a very important question. How you live your life today will determine where you will be. God has already paid the price. God has already given you and I the destiny. A destiny to be like a God in this fallen world. A destiny to be a blessing, to restore, to bring God's love, God's peace, the restoration even. That's why the whole of creation is groaning for the manifestation of God's glory. He didn't say that. He's groaning for the manifestation of the sons of glory. Amen. I already said this word. In this season, God spoke to me this very clearly. This is a season right now that there's going to be such a manifestation that the knowledge of the glory of God will be covering the earth as the waters cover the sea. The manifestation of God is about God's presence being brought, God's salvation being extended, God's calling to redeem. We who have been ransomed and redeemed have the role to be the instrument and conduit of His redemptive work. Amen. To bring His love, to bring His peace, to bring restoration, to bring the glory realm, to bring, how many know, as we go out and preach the gospel, God will work with us with signs, miracles, and wonders. You're called with a purpose. You're paid for with a price. And this is where to be in a place of significance. Understand your destiny. And remember I said these words. Understand destiny, understand the plans and purpose of God. But understand that you need to prepare, you need to position. Amen? If you don't prepare, you don't position, you'll never be able to be called out as God wants to call you out. That's quite nice. And Father, it's in this season right now. We know that day is coming in soon. You remind us to live for the day. The example we see, Father, even the life of Reuben and the life of Simeon and Levi. God, help us even right now, God, that we will not be found wanting, Lord, in the final day. I thank you for the gift of the Holy Spirit. I thank you for leading and guiding of the Holy Spirit. I thank you for your love that's already been extended to us. Lord, I've spoken about the fruit of that Holy Spirit itself. Help us, God. Let us align. Let us prepare. But help us, the people, to rise up, to be called out, God, to be able to say, God, it's all about you. And we want to be, Lord, your manifestation of your glory. We want to extend the love, joy, peace of yours, God. We want to get our focus right, God, not our own agendas, not our own priorities, Lord. But God, I know this, that when we align to what you want us to do, you said the rest will be added unto us. Whatever cares and concerns, whatever anxieties and worries, God, you can take care of it. So I pray even right now for every family that worships here at Covenant Vision Christian Church, that we can understand, God, not only the destiny, God, we can understand the place of significance that you want to us to rise up unto and to be the person of influence for you, Lord. So God, as we commit this time to you, to you, Lord, be all glory, all honor and power and praise. And we give you thanks for each family right now. In Jesus' precious name.